Discuss real-time programming today. Suppose you have two browsers to choose from, browser A and B. A loads every page in 4 seconds. Browser B loads every page in 0.0001 seconds. But once in a month, it takes 60 seconds. Let me Slack it to you here. Which browser would you use? Right, everyone would use browser B. Now suppose A and B are not browsers, but nuclear reactor control systems. The first one behaves in a predictable way every time, the second one hangs once in a month for 60 seconds. Now which nuclear reactor control system would you like if there's a reactor next to your house? Exactly, right? So you can see I have not changed the problem at all. The problem is still the same, or the parameters are still the same. And in one case, you chose one option, and in the second case, you chose the other option. So a real-time program is when you care about predictability. People think real-time means fast. It doesn't. It just means predictable. So in this case, A is predictable. It behaves the same way every time, even though it is much slower. It's probably a million times slower than B, or whatever the ratio is, 4 divided by 0.0001. Right? So real-time does not mean fast. Real-time means predictable. Real time also means you care about the worst case performance. Unlike general time, general programming, where you care about the average case, right? So if your Swiggy delivery comes on time most of the time, once in 2 months it's delayed, you don't mind too much, right? You care about the average case. But if you have a nuclear reactor that melts down every month, that's not an acceptable option, right? So generally, we care about the average case, but when we are doing real-time programming, we care about the worst case. The third way of defining real-time, right? The first was predictability, not speed. The second was worst case versus average case. The third way of defining what a real-time program is that performance is part of correctness. That being late is as bad as giving the wrong answer. So going back to the nuclear reactor example, if the program reacts after the reactor has melted down, there's no point at all, right? As opposed to, let's say you need to get a cash back on your credit card and that gets credited after 2 days. You don't mind because you got your cash back. So there, the time is not such a critical element of the correctness. So real-time program is one where performance is part of correctness. Within real time, there are two versions, hard and soft. Hard real time is like the nuclear reactor we discussed. Soft real time, an example is FutureCam. And I know everyone has seen the website, but for those of you who haven't, I'm just messaging here on the chat. And here, for example, if you're capturing a video of a car moving across a road, you're getting frames at, let's say, 30 or 60 frames a second. Let's take 30. Now, if your program hangs for, let's say, 50 milliseconds, 50 milliseconds doesn't seem a lot. But in that 50 milliseconds, you have lost 3 frames. So the car will appear to be stuck in one place and then suddenly jump ahead rather than moving smoothly. So that is a soft real-time problem where, yeah, it's not as bad as a nuclear reactor. The user will not uninstall the app and immediately write a 1-star review. But there is a real problem there, right? So I worked only in soft real time. And soft real time is an order of magnitude more complex and demanding than non-real time. Hard real time is even more complex and demanding, one more order of magnitude, and I haven't gone there yet. In case of FutureCam, after I got it working, after the average case performance was good, after I had optimized it to process 1 GB of data every second on the smartphone, even after that, making it work predictably, making it real time took 1 quarter for me personally, right? So before that, everything was done. Image capture was done. Image processing was done. Edge cases were handled. Everything was built. But just going from good average performance with occasional hiccups to good worst case performance took me 1 quarter. So never underestimate real-time programming. If you can find a way to avoid real-time programming, such as capturing a video and processing it afterward instead of processing it in real-time, take that option, even at the cost of UX. Don't be like, this is the ideal UX I want to build, and now I have to figure out the technology, the algorithms to make it work. Don't take that approach. Take the approach of, this is a good trade-off to make. And if you have a discussion in your company, like say the designer or whoever the stakeholder, maybe marketer, who says, hey, this should be the right way of doing it, ask them, do you want the entire team to spend 1 quarter more? Right? Because that is a trade-off you are looking at. So if you can find a way to avoid it, avoid it. Even if there's a price to pay, pay it. Let's discuss in the rest of this talk some techniques used in real-time programming. But before that, does anyone have any questions, thoughts about FutureCam, about real-time programming in general, anything? Okay. So let's look at some techniques that we use. First, multi-threading is mandatory because you need that level of performance. Because if you have a single thread, it can block, even if you use async calls. And you can't block, right? Real time, you should always be ready to accept input. You can't be like, let me finish what I'm doing, then I will respond to input, right? Because if you're capturing a video at 30 frames a second, we are not even talking about high frame rates, right? Recent iPhones capture up to 240 frames a second. We're not even talking about that. Even if you take minimum 30 frames a second, then you are getting a frame every what? 33 milliseconds, right? 1000 by 30. Now, if you hang for 50 milliseconds, you have dropped a frame. So single-threaded real-time programming does not make sense. Even if you use async, even if you use promises, futures, any of these programming techniques, say JavaScript, which we use with a single thread, it's not going to work. The second technique we use is we sacrifice UX to some extent, like responsiveness. So in FutureCam, we had a video queue. And a queue is iOS nomenclature for a thread. So I'll just call it a thread. So the video thread would handle only video processing work, as the name says. And that thread's responsiveness was prioritized even above the UI, which is not how you do any kind of mobile programming, iOS or Android. The way you're supposed to do mobile programming in general is you have a UI thread. That thread should always have the highest priority, should always be responsive. The UI should never freeze. You do whatever you want in the background. So for example, if you're scrolling with an infinite scroll and you need to load an image, do it in a background thread. Don't block the UI waiting for the network or anything, or the disk or anything, right? So that is how you're supposed to do mobile programming. But in case of FutureCam, I violated that. I prioritized the real-time thread, the video thread, over the main thread. So even though there were times when the UX was not 100% responsive, it's fine. So that is a trade-off we need to make. Like on the whole, it was super responsive, just in some cases. Now, if you ask a perfectionist, be it a designer or a mobile engineer who has very high standards, he will say this is not how it should be. And he's right in general, but not when it comes to real-time programming. That is a sacrifice you have to make. Moving on. In FutureCam, we had some processing that needed to be done in real time as the user is capturing a video. And let's see how this 1 Gbps number comes. If each frame in the video is 12 megapixels, which it is on the iPhone, 12, I just type in the chat box. Each has RGB components, right? Red, green, blue. And you have 30 in a second. That is 960 Mbps, almost 1 Gbps. And that's megabytes here, not megabits. So it's like 7 gigabits per second or 1 gigabyte per second, right? So that is the speed with which you need to work. Now, any algorithm, if it is not fast enough to process so much data. So first of all, if the device performance itself is not enough, anyway, it won't work, no matter what programming techniques you use. You can't make a bullock cart go 200 kilometers per hour, no matter how much you hack it. So anyway, that's not going to work. But that's not the case we are discussing. That's not feasible. We are discussing a case where you have an algorithm that works, but occasionally runs into hiccups. If you want to take a real world example of hiccups, if a company offers chat, if they offer chat support, no, chat is not a good example, phone call support, a call center. When you call, they have to answer immediately. If they answer after 10 minutes, it's not going to work. Whereas if they have chat support, they can answer after 10 minutes, right? So now if you have a support team, and you want to offer phone support, you need to hire many more people if you want to offer a good service to people. And most of the time they'll be sitting idle because you have to handle the peak. If the peak is, let's say, 100 calls per minute or 100 simultaneous calls, you need to hire 100 people. Most of the time you'll get only 10 calls at once and the remaining 90 are sitting idle. In this case, it's a question of economics, but if you take the same principle and apply it to real-time programming, you can have an algorithm that cannot handle things even in the normal case. But if you have an algorithm whose performance keeps going up and down like a wave, for whatever reason, right? Maybe garbage collection kicks in. Thankfully, iOS doesn't use garbage collection. Otherwise, this would have probably been even harder. But any reason, if there's a hiccup and the graph goes down, the sine wave goes down, even the lowest point should be fast enough for you, right? So if you have an algorithm that works, but occasionally is slow, let's call it capital X, right? We have this algorithm capital X whose average case performance is enough, but not worst case performance. So I used another algorithm, small x, which did only part of the work that capital X did. But it had better performance. Its worst case performance was good enough. The problem was it didn't do all the work of capital X. And the output it produced was not in the right format. Then I had to write a post-processing algorithm Y, which also took up time. So instead of capital X, you split it into two parts, small x and Y. And Y runs after the capturing is over, at which point it's no longer a real-time program. So if you look at the real-time part of it, you replace capital X with small x, which is easier to do. This made it slower for the user because after the capture was done, he had to wait some time. But again, that was a trade-off that made sense. Did you guys understand this? Capital X, small x business? Yeah, so basically you're replacing one algorithm with another, making the real-time part of it smaller. So if you can split a real-time algorithm into two parts, one is real-time, one is non-real-time, and the real-time part is smaller, that's a good thing to do, even if the total time is more for the user. And even for us, now we have to build two algorithms. So this is an example of a more general technique of making just one part of a program real-time rather than the whole thing. So if you have a reactor control system, let's say, and maybe one of the tasks is send a daily report to some senior person, let's say, that would be a non-real-time program. So there you should explore things like, can I run it on a different computer so that even if it hangs or crashes or takes up 100% CPU, then the reactor control logic is not affected. So that's an example of splitting or making one part of the program real time rather than the whole thing. The other technique we use is reduce the scope of the problem. For example, with FutureCam, I cared only about the recent iPhones. If someone had a 3-year iPhone, I didn't care. It would drop frames. And one or two users complained, and I said, yes, unfortunately, it's optimized for newer iPhones. That was a conscious trade-off I made. So reduce the scope of the problem. The other technique is abstraction, which is very important. It's an important programming technique in general at any scale. So because if everyone worries about everything, it may work in a 1-person team, but not at our size, maybe 2-person team. So abstraction is an important concept in general, but it's even more important in real-time programming, because real-time programming is generally used for complex programs, complex problems, right? So when the complexity is more, like FutureCam, anyway you need abstraction. Otherwise, even with one person or a small team, you won't be able to work with it. So you are solving a complex problem to begin with. So your solution, your code will be complex. On top of that, when you make it real time, it makes it even more complex. So to handle so much complexity, abstraction is a critical tool. You need to know how to use it. You need to understand principles like modularity, cohesion, coupling, all these things, right? The other thing you need to do is, while you need to understand abstraction, you should also be good at peeling back the covers of system abstractions to understand how they work. So for example, iOS has a hardware encoder for images and videos. How does that work? And if you try to encode an image and it takes 100 milliseconds, let's say, does it mean you can encode 10 images in a second? No, actually you can encode 15 or whatever the number is, more. Because latency and throughput are two different things, right? Everyone understands the difference between latency and throughput? Cool. So, point is, you can't treat the system APIs, the APIs provided by the OS, as black boxes and say, okay, this is how it works. No, you need to open the black box, look inside it and understand. This is hard with closed source components like in iOS, but you still have to do it. And it's the hard way. It takes time, maybe a year, right? And people say things like, yeah, in a startup, we need to move fast, iterate, all these things. Which is true, but not when it comes to real-time programming. You cannot move fast in real-time programming. Any more than you can build a spaceship in your backyard in 2021 working by yourself. So how do you understand closed source components, the internals of it? One is experience. The other is you experiment with different things. You say, maybe this works. You become a scientist. You form a hypothesis and you test it. And you say, oh, this didn't work. Maybe that is how it works. You form a different hypothesis and you try to validate it. And of course, you learn from other people's experience on Stack Overflow and other places. And it's rare you get an insight, but when you get an insight, that single Stack Overflow answer you read may save you months of work. The other thing you do is you warm things, you warm the system. So for example, when the user records a video, we do some processing. But before he taps the shutter button, we run our algorithms to do video processing on the data, but we throw away the result of it instead of saving it. And why do we do that? Like, that's weird, right? Why do you want to process 1 GB of data every second and throw it away even before the user presses the shutter button to start the video? The answer is the GPU gets warmed up. And with OpenGL, which I use, I tried Metal also, Apple's API for GPU computing. I found OpenGL to work just as well. So I stuck with OpenGL. OpenGL shaders are compiled on use. It's not like C++ where you compile them ahead of time. It is compiled on use. It's more like an interpreter or a JIT type of thing like Java, right? Like Java bytecode. So initially you had a problem where the user presses the shutter button to start recording and the first few frames are all dropped because the system has not warmed up. And then it starts recording. With this change, this warming up was done ahead of time, the GPU and everything, right? The compiling the code and everything. So, yeah, so anyway, this is one technique, warming thing. The other thing is time complexity analysis. The algorithms we used were linear in the number of frames. Initially, I came up with an algorithm that is quadratic. It's not going to work. Certainly when processing 1 GB of data, basically. So you need to think about these things, right? And if you're processing very less messages, it's or less amount of data, it's fine, it can be quadratic. But so much data definitely matters. The other thing you need to do is you need to come up with design principles and document them and stick with them. So for example, we discussed the video thread. And we had a rule that says you can do only video processing on the video thread. For example, you can't save a video to the gallery on this thread. It's not a video saving thread, it's a video processing thread. So you have to, even in a small team, I had to write it in Google Docs. Otherwise the remaining three engineers in the team did not understand or they understood something different from what I intended. So finally the rules were violated and the system didn't work that way. So we had to come up with a process where we identify 4 or 5 design guidelines, put them in a Google Doc. We all have a meeting, had a meeting, made sure everyone understood. So one guy didn't, one guy misunderstood, thought they had a question. We all went through this. And then we reached an agreement and we stuck with it. Right? So these kind of processes are needed. This video thread cannot block for other threads because if it is blocking, it's not real time anymore. Then how do you synchronize between multiple threads? The answer is other threads need to block for this thread. Even the main thread. Normally, a good principle of mobile programming is never block the main thread, but here we block the main thread. So all these architectural decisions need to be made, agreed upon, validated, and tested. The other thing is when you do multi-threading, you end up with race conditions, and these are annoying. We had a situation where we were trying to launch a feature and we got it working. We thought, okay, we are done. We launch this week. And then some small bugs kept happening. I said, okay, 1 or 2 small bugs, but then there was a third. And I didn't feel comfortable launching because the quality was not good enough. I said, okay, 2 more weeks. And then we worked on it. We didn't make progress. And then, okay, 2 more weeks. And then we fixed 1 of the bugs, but the other 2 bugs kept happening. This cycle went on for 2 months. And then I realized I was making ad hoc fixes. I needed to make architectural fixes. In general, that's a good guideline. If you're making ad hoc fixes, and often ad hoc fixes are the right thing because you don't want to redo your architecture every single day for every trivial problem. But if it is not working again and again and again, that's a good indication that you need to attack it at an architectural level. And we had problems like deadlock, where thread A was waiting on B and B was waiting on A. So the entire system hung, it would never make progress. And when you work with real time, as I said, you need multiple threads. And when you have multiple threads, you have synchronization, race conditions, all these problems, right? This is very, very hard. It's the hardest kind of programming I have done. So multi-threaded programming, right? So anyway, so the point is you need to identify when the approach you're taking is not working and say, we need to tackle this at an architectural level and come up with these guidelines. And the first guidelines I came up with did not work for whatever reason. Then I had to iterate on them. The second version worked. After that, we launched and in 6 months, we did not have even 1 bug. It was very hard work, identifying the principles, having the right level of abstraction, making sure the code is in sync with the principles we have identified. Very easy to make a mistake somewhere, actually. I think even to this day, I am the only one who understands how this part of the system works, the real-time part of it. Everyone else understands all the other parts, They understand UI, data storage, analytics, Firebase, the payment APIs, all those they understand. But I think this is the thing that only I understand. The other technique you need to use is GPU computing or vector computing. And you need to understand how the hardware works. So for example, iPhones can save a video either in the older H.264 format or the newer HEVC format. And there are two hardware encoders for each of these formats. And the same video encoder also works for images. So if you are using Heek and HEVC, they use the same encoder. But H.264 uses another encoder. JPEG, I don't know, maybe it uses a third encoder. I don't know, maybe it is done in software. I think it's done in hardware. So you need to understand all of these things, right, at a low level. And you need to use GPU and vector computing. So we use GPU computing. We tried vector computing also. And Apple has a framework for vImage. Sorry, framework called vImage for image processing on the vector units of the CPU. Its performance was lower than the GPU, maybe half or a third. It would still process 300, 400 MB of data every second, which is a lot for a mobile device, but that was not good enough. So we tried both. We stuck with GPU. And like I said, Apple GPUs, Apple platforms have two APIs, right? OpenGL, which is the old one, which is deprecated, and Metal, the newer one. And the older one was fine. In fact, it was better in some ways. In fact, I had an idea. If the GPU can do a certain amount of work, and the vector units can do a certain amount of work, what if I use both? So I built a framework that distributes work between the GPU and the vector units. For whatever reason, it didn't work. And I didn't have time to investigate it thoroughly. You need low-level integration with the OS using OS APIs at the appropriate level of abstraction. So for example, Apple uses Core Image for image processing, which is a layer on top of the GPU. I could have directly used the GPU, but there was no benefit for that particular task. So you need to understand the layers of the OS. If you want to encode an image, let's say, compress an image, and so we need to realize what we need to control and what we don't need to control, which is where using the right abstraction comes in, the right level of the APIs. So if you are encoding an image, the lowest level of API on Apple systems is called Image I/O. On top of that, there's something else. Forgetting the name right now. On top of that, there's something else. So you need to understand which layer you need to work. So for image encoding, we use the lowest level. For video encoding, we use the second lowest level API. So that is one thing. Strictly limiting use of resources like memory is important, and reusing things. So if you are processing 1 GB of data at a time, right, every second, you can't say, yeah, just buffer it, I'll take care of it later. Because if you buffer it for 1 second, you have used up 1 GB of memory. And the first naive algorithm I wrote would allocate 1 GB every second and crash into 3 seconds. So you have to very strictly limit resources. You can't say just allocate memory, use it. No, you have to allocate a fixed amount of memory and use it. And we had 7 image buffers. Originally started with 11. It worked most of the time, but sometimes it would crash. Then I made it 9, then 8. Finally, 7 would never crash on the recent efforts. So you need to very strictly limit these resources. And these things are not documented. There isn't a formula that says, oh, this is what you need to do. You have to figure all this out by trial and error. And you need timelines measured in years, not weeks, to do real-time programming. Especially if you haven't done it before. Like if someone else is to build a future camp today, it'll take them years. It'll take me much faster, maybe months, if I have to code everything from scratch. you need project management which is flexible. You can't have a pointy head boss here. You need an understanding boss. You can't have someone who will demand. You said it will take 10 days and it took 11 days and it's not done. Why is that? You know, that kind of project management approach doesn't work. You need a more flexible understanding. Things will get delayed. So one critical thing you need is, when I am spending time, is it worth it? Certain things can cost a quarter to implement. And I didn't know ahead of time all the time. Later on, I learned and I started making better decisions. But if I had the foresight or the knowledge, I would have said, no, this is a better UX, but let's not do it because it will cost us one quarter of time. These cross-disciplinary trade-offs you need to be able to make. You can't say I'm an engineer, so I think only like an engineer, or I'm a designer, I think only like a designer. You have to consider all the perspectives and make a decision. So anyway, these are some thoughts I had about real-time program. Do you guys have any questions?